If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this extremely motivating episode,
you can do it,
of Mind Pump, for the first 33 minutes, we talk about a few fun topics. We talk about cannasexuals.
What the hell is that?
Married couples and sex. We actually talk about our own personal sex lives.
We did.
Yep.
That was pretty much, I would say the first half was like all of our personal sex
our
lives.
Our personal sex lives.
For about 33 minutes.
Adam and I had a lot to say.
You guys were dirty. You both are dirty.
Justin was pretty quiet.
Then we talked about sexual drive. And then we get into, I guess, the topic of the episode, motivation. Is it bullshit? What's up with all these motivational speakers and you got to get motivated to do everything?
Do you need these guys barking at you all day long?
Yeah. Also, look, this month, MAPS Anabolic is 50% off all month long.
What did you say?
50% off.
What?
Basically, you take the price, you cut it in half. That's what you pay.
Wow.
It's been going, it was $117 is the normal price for MAPS Anabolic?
It's a gift from us.
It's under $60. For the foundational MAPS program. You can find that at mindpumpmedia.com. You can also find our bundles where we take multiple MAPS programs and put them together. For example, our super bundle is a year of exercise programming. So if you're really serious about fitness, get your entire year planned out for you with the super bundle. You can find that, the other bundles, and MAPS Anabolic at 50% off, all at mindpumpmedia.com.
Is that the Budweiser like lion on your shirt?
No.
It looks like the Budweiser lion.
No.
I like it. Yeah. What is that?
It's I have no idea.
You don't.
Liked it.
I like it. I like it too.
It's a very small lion on my shirt.
It looks it looks cool.
That's
and it goes you got a flossy watch.
Reminds me of that other
wear watches yet.
I appreciate that.
Brand. What are you doing right now? What's coming next?
Yeah.
He's getting all regal on us.
What's coming next?
You think he's going to give you a shit sandwich right now?
Just you don't do the sandwich. You do the top layer. The rest is just
open face.
Open face shit sandwich. So have you guys heard of the term cannasexuals?
Cannasexuals.
What do you think that means?
Are we still making shit up? Is that what's going on?
People that fuck marijuana plants.
that would make sense. No, these are people who like to use cannabis for sex, but in particular, it's women who like to spray or use cannabis-based like oils or sprays or whatever on their
vagina.
Vagine.
Uh-huh. Yeah, of course, to numb it.
So this is a like
you want to have some marathon sex.
This is like a meetup group. Is that what's going on?
No, I'm reading this article, and it's talking about how these women like to use it because it helps them get orgasms, but just not because it numbs it.
Yeah,
why would you want to numb your vagina
so you can go all night?
They don't need it. They don't need it. That's for men. Men need to numb their stuff. Women can go all night if they want to.
Not all women like to have 10 orgasms. Not all like that.
I like how Adam looks at me and he's like, listen, Sal.
A lot of them told me it's too much. Yeah,
trust me.
I mean, it's overkill.
Yeah. I have a problem.
Yeah.
Yeah. Women don't like it when I do that to them all the time, every day.
It's exhausting.
All day. Yeah. They don't like that. No.
Still want to work.
They put it on their vaginas or in their vaginas. Because I feel like I threw an R
in or around the vaginas.
Yeah, it's because it. This is what one person says.
What one person says?
I'm reading a quote.
Then it's valid, right? Yeah, there.
That's what
all I need.
I feel a warmth and comfort down there that I wouldn't without it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think we're gonna see lots of stuff with cannabis start coming out. Because
you know, here's what I don't.
It's already. You know what sucks?
What sucks?
It's slowly becoming uncool.
To do weed?
Yes.
We're going to have to move to heroin soon, guys. We're going to have to start using heroin.
It's like sucks, man. Dude. It's already getting uncool.
No, you know what? You know what?
It's like when your parents are smoking it and like everybody like
my
like,
fucking
hella
dad.
Nerdy friends.
Yeah. Yeah. Dude, my parents use it for like their own ailments and stuff.
It's called
for sleep
weed.
And whatever.
Yeah.
So here's the thing about some studies like this, because they'll do a study and they'll be like, oh, people who use cannabis spray on the vaginas report having 50%.
Yeah, but is it localized right there? Like, is that like the effect? If it's like a lube or like something like that?
I don't know about that. Plus, it takes a long
time
to hit you.
I'm like, is that true?
Plus, it takes a long time to hit you. So what do? You spray it and then you're like, listen.
How can you localize it right there if it goes to your bloodstream?
I don't know. It might have a local effect, but it takes a while. So what do they do? Like, and then they're like, "All right, honey, listen, we're gonna watch TV for an hour."
Well, yeah. That's why I said numbing. Right. That's the only thing that makes sense to me, because we used to make like these rubbing alcohol for like pain and stuff like that, and you could rub it on the skin and it would actually.
I don't think that works.
Yeah.
No. You know why? Because when you're rubbing it on a local area, it has to go through the skin, and then it doesn't go just to that area. It goes systemically. Now, cold shit or like, what is it called? Like menthol and stuff?
Right, for anti-inflammatory stuff.
Like, well, no. That works, but not because it's doing something directly to the area that you're putting it on, but because it distracts the central nervous system and it confuses the signal. So it feels cold instead of pain, and so you're like, oh, it doesn't hurt. That's how that works. But here's the deal. With studies like this, the reason why I think they're crazy is, let's say you take a poll of people. Yeah.
Well, okay. That was one person you mentioned.
No, that was a quote. That was just a quote. Oh, okay. That was just a quote. So
it worked for me.
End
of study.
Yeah. Studies show that one person.
Well, let's say you did a study, right? Or not a study, a survey, because they didn't have done studies. It was surveys. They said women who reported using cannabis vaginal spray report 50% more orgasms than women who don't. Here's why that study is terrible. Because I feel like the women that are likely to use a spray on their vagina before sex are the kind that are probably more likely to be relaxed and have orgasms. You know what I'm saying? Like, imagine if you're going to hook up with a girl.
No, I could totally say that. If you got a girl who's already like very insecure or scared,
she's not going to be like, hold on a second.
Pretentious, like, she doesn't want to do certain things.
Right.
And like, yeah, like the last thing you're going to do is be like, hey, why don't you spray some marijuana on your vag? Like, she's going to be like, yeah, that sounds like a great idea. No,
exactly.
That girl's going to be no.
Exactly.
She's a prude. The girl that's more end up exploring things.
Exactly.
Who's just probably like, already having better orgasms anyway.
That's my point. Because there was another study a while ago.
I agree with that.
That got a lot of controversy. And they did a survey of women, and they found that women who have anal sex report far more orgasms than women that don't have anal sex. Yeah. And so the...
Send me that. You know what I mean? give me that study. So you're holding out on me.
I'm trying to talk, and I hear Justin in the back, and he's going,
like, yeah. I like what you're saying.
Facts to me, please.
So, but the problem with that study is, they took that study, and they're like, oh, anal sex gives you orgasms.
No, they're just more adventurous.
I think women who are like, and people who are more likely to do these things are more likely to have good sex, and it's not necessarily the thing that they're doing, it's the fact that they're willing to do them.
What did Doug,
you know what I'm saying?
Random question here, you could Google for me. I'm putting you to work today, dude. Could you
Captain Google?
I wanna know that the how often the average married couple has sex?
Once a week.
Is it really?
I think it's 3 to 4 times a month, something like that. 3 to 5 times a month. Something like that.
Once a week average.
I know this because I use this in arguments.
Are you above or below average, Justin?
Wow.
I'm above.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Well, actually, let's see what the average is first, and then I can ask that question.
Yeah, well.
Based off of Sal's facts there.
Yeah.
Let's see where it's at.
54 times a year, or a little more than once a week. Yeah. It's almost as if I can't be wrong.
So. Or we just happen to talk about all the things that you Google.
Yeah.
So once a week is the average.
Right around.
Wow.
Yeah.
Babe, you hear that? She bitches about 3 times, dude.
Your girl?
Yes.
That's how it always starts, man.
Yeah. That's how it's. Yeah. You don't have kids, homie.
Yeah, dude. It's not. This is not you the same playing field.
Hey,
anymore.
Bro. You no shit, dude. Why do you think I'm not married? 7 years deep. We're in a great relationship still. Yeah. It's still going like this.
And then you want to hold out so you get good sex. You know what I mean? You don't want to just like have it.
Oh, my marriage. It just started,
you don't want sympathy sex.
Nah, man. Yeah.
There you go.
That's the thing, too.
How many married couples get that sex, dude?
A lot.
Sympathy sex?
Yes.
A lot. Well, you know why, dude? Because it's an important part of a relationship. I think people start to, you know, well, I don't want to talk about it.
There's a lot. It's going to go down a dark path.
Go ahead. Finish your sentence here. I'm really curious what you have to say about this.
Here's the thing. Sex is not that important unless something's wrong with it. And then it becomes very important. Otherwise, a healthy relationship can be a lot of sex, not that much sex. But if there's a problem with one of the people in there, then it becomes an issue.
Somebody's unhappy or whatever.
Because it's very individual. Like, okay, that's the average, right? You know what that means? That means half of the married couples have more than that, and half of the married couples have less than that, because that's the average.
Right.
So, you know, you could be in a marriage where, you know, a guy...
Which, that's actually really crazy to me, because obviously there's a lot of people that are doing it 2-3 times a week that probably fall in the category of where I'm at, right? And who knows... Where are you at? Where are you at right now?
Right now?
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
We know where you were at when you guys first got in your relationship. Are you still keeping that pace?
You know, we do. We go in insane spurts. So, yeah.
So look at a month. We average. Won't have. So don't look at like a.
We
a,
won't. I don't know. It's hard to catch. So there'll be like a day or two where we don't have sex, and then it's like
we should all track for the next 45 days.
Then it's like
days.
A bunch all day.
We should all track for that'd the next 45 days.
Track.
That'd be really.
It just sounds like that'd be easy. For
right, me. I could probably predict it.
Yeah. No.
You know what I mean, yeah.
I have a lot. Now. See, I'm a very sexual person, so for me, once a week would be too little. But here's the deal. I'll take that back. I wouldn't mind once a week sex if it was good. In fact, I don't care about the frequency as much as I care about the quality. That's the truth, 100%. I really don't care. If I had once a month mind-blowing crazy sex, that would be fine. Mm. That would be fine. It's got to be the quality is more important. When I was younger, quantity was important.
Yeah.
As I'm older, I
definitely go in.
It's all about the enthusiasm.
I go in spurts, like you're saying too. But when I say 3 times a week, I would say that's spurts. My average, right?
3 times, yeah.
Yeah, because we'll have a week where it's crazy. It's 5 or 6, and then we'll have a week where it's 2 or 1, right?
Yeah.
So I don't know. One, I'm getting a lot of shit. If it's like a crazy week.
So are you the one giving the sympathy sex?
I'm not going to answer that. Yeah. Set me up like that. No. I would never give my girl sympathy sex. But I definitely, for sure, if it was up to her, we would consistently be somewhere between 5 and 7.
Consistently.
I'm just too tired for that. Yeah. Dude. I mean, I train hard, man. I lift a lot of weights. I do a lot of things. My mind's working a lot.
Yeah.
That's a lot to ask.
It is a lot.
And because I bring it every time, too. I'm not like a half-ass sex guy.
Yeah, you're a full ass.
Yeah, full
all ass.
All ass.
Full
yeah.
on.
All day.
Yeah, yeah.
Round no. ass.
I, every time, 7 years later, you ask Katrina next time we talk to her, too. 7 years later. I mean, every time
you
I go
even
into-
tell. I don't tell. I believe
yeah,
you.
Let's ask yeah. her.
Yeah. I know. I text her. We talk. Yeah. How's your sex life?
Cross-check it.
She tells me all the time. Yeah. you imagine?
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Yeah.
I come up. Hey, bro, I got to talk to you real quick.
Hey,
I was talking to your girl.
Yeah.
No, I think quality is so much more important than quantity. Quantity is important too, of course. I mean, I said the once a month thing, and now that I think about it, that probably would be too little. But once a week, really good sex, I would be happy. But it has to be like really good. And what makes good sex? How about that? That's a better question. What makes sex for you guys good? Where you're like, wow, that was yeah. quality.
It has to be like very enthusiastic. You know, like it has to.
Like
I'm into this.
What a great adjective, right? Yeah.
Enthusiasm at an all-time high.
Yeah,
that really helps. You
like
know,
when she brings the pom-poms.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, let's do this, honey.
I'm not mad at that at all.
You don't want to see her like peek at the clock real quick.
What was Courtney like in high school? Was she what click did she?
She played volleyball.
Oh, so she was an athlete.
Yeah, she's an athlete. Kind of. I mean, she wasn't like super competitive. Like she didn't like. Play like basically she was like really good but like was disinterested in it because like the coaches and whatever it was
right.
She was like not into that, but yeah, she was an athlete and hung out with athletes and stuff, so
not yeah. cheerleader or anything.
No, she wasn't her sister, which is kind of strange to me because her sister, her older one, is very fiercely independent, you know, has her own business, is like a lawyer, and like she was a cheerleader, and I was just like, what? Like, I don't know. There's just like this.
Well, there's a stigma that comes
stigma,
with it.
Right. And it's just a different, like, I just didn't see that in my mind, you know? So that kind of threw me off.
See,
it was kind of funny to find that out.
At our school, we probably had like a 50-50 split. We had like half the cheerleader girls were following the stigma, right? Of the kind of ditzy, whatever. But the other half were actually the, you know, AP classes, smart girls.
Oh, yeah. There were some things. Smart girls for sure. It's something like enjoyed doing. But yeah,
enthusiasm is what you look for.
So for you,
I like the cheerleader.
Yeah. What about you, Adam?
For me, it's like, and I know when we hit this point, right, there becomes a point where you lose track of time and everything else. Like, and it's literally, you feel like, it almost feels like you're having sex with yourself. It's, no, I'm serious. Like, we become one.
Hey, Adam, what's the best kind of sex?
You'd say that.
I like banging me.
In front of a bunch of mirrors.
Yeah. I mean,
it's a hall of mirrors.
when we get connected like that, it literally feels like there's no wrong move or turn. Like you literally feel like one person.
That's making love transition.
Right. Like
that's
so when you get that connected.
Nothing's better than lovemaking.
That to me is the but don't get me wrong, like I also feel like there's times, like if her and I have been stressed and frustrated, this and that, and we're going back and smash it out. Right. Then there's definitely the pull the hair, throw her over the bed. Too. She wasn't ready for it type of deal.
She pulls your
hair?
That's
why it's hard to say, dude. It depends on the mood.
Fucking guy.
She's pulling Adam's hair. He's like, ow.
Sometimes, you know, it's a pegging sesh, you know?
Yeah, I think.
Oh, my God. Oh my God! Did you say pegging?
Yeah, you're talking about pulling his hair. I'm just saying
that's a term.
Why else would you do that?
That's a term I learned.
What's pegging? What?
Oh man,
you don't know what pegging is?
I found this out too.
No, what's pegging?
This is a thing, dude. Where a girl puts on a role reversal. A girl puts on a strap on.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Yep.
Yeah. There's a term for this.
There is a term.
I just thought it was like a girl puts. It's called pegging.
Pegging. P-E-G-G-I-N-G.
Sounds appropriate for what it is.
Can you Google that real quick, just Adam? Doug, I want to see what we. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah. No, it's not.
Yeah, that's what it's called. So anyway, so you're talking about making love.
Yeah, I mean,
I would rather make, how do you define that, right?
Like, for I don't know if that's the...
Well, making love is, it's like what you're saying.
I think making love is defined by each person individually, right? I just know that there's times when we have sex and it literally becomes timeless and it feels as if you were alone. And what I mean by alone, it's not that I feel like I'm having sex by myself, but literally like you feel like you're one body.
Yeah. Well, you're really just crazy. Both in the same like wavelength.
Yes.
In the same like alignment and it's seamless at that point. I think everybody has experienced that at some point.
Anybody that's ever, you know, or if you're into dancing, right? It's like when you dance, like you're dancing with somebody who just literally vibes with you completely.
It's the no pants dance.
Yeah, it's the no pants. Dance. So that's what I think is epic, great sex.
That's good,
right?
Yeah, mm-hmm.
And I'm shooting for that every time. You know, I mean that's the goal is to do that.
It is.
What's yours?
I like
animal noises.
Yeah,
that's what I feel like.
Yeah. Two people, three people? No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, yeah.
For me, it's when there's no boundaries, and what I mean by that is not that you do everything, but you feel.
You roll out the plastic sheets.
Yeah, you get the Wesson oil.
Yeah,
there's no boundaries when it's you.
No boundaries.
What I mean by that is where you feel
safe words.
You feel very.
Do you guys have a safe word?
Is it?
What is your safe word? No, I don't have a safe word. No. Yeah, no, we haven't had. We haven't hit something that needed a safe word so far.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, the safe word is
party.
The safe word is ouch. Yeah.
Like, I don't know. Yeah,
I hit the safe word. No, no boundaries. I do like talking. I like communicating through sex. I like to talk, converse. I like dirty talk. I like. To hear and
God, I feel like if I was dating you, I'd want you to shut your mouth because you talk all the time.
I don't like talking. You'd like the way I did it, bro.
Oh, you would?
Yeah. Rock your world.
That's so awkward.
Really awkward.
Oh man.
No, I like no boundaries. I like obviously, of course, connection. Like you said, where you feel like you lose time, and then there's those times where it's pure animal. Sex where it's just pure filth and pure, like anger. And
those seem to after fights. That's why I feel like
that's the kind of sex where
disagreements, big arguments.
That's the kind of
mad
sex
at each other. This is it. I'm done with you. I'm finding someone new. Oh, I'm just kidding. I love you.
Yeah. No, that's the kind of sex where afterwards you think to yourself like, ooh, I don't know if I could bring that up.
I gotta take a shower.
Let's not bring up what happened just now. We'll pretend that didn't happen.
Now do you guys know your women because you've been with them for a long time. Is there certain feedback that you're looking for? Like, is there like, oh, when she tells me that, like I know I did it.
See, me and my girl are very similar, so she's vocal like I am, so I know.
I just know the noises. Yeah. I'm like, oh, hitting a good spot right there. I'm going to keep driving that one.
Yeah.
This sounds nothing like that sound.
Would you say
please don't ever put that in my mind.
Would you say keep driving?
keep driving in on that signal.
This is like a jackhammer.
I see how Justin...
You guys think I'm all rough, dude? I'm super, super sensitive, dude.
Bro, I have never seen you be... like that with anything. I've seen how you eat food, how you handle objects.
Fair enough.
I do have that ability.
Ability of both ends.
I do believe there's a correlation between how men eat and how they fuck. I really do. I do believe there's a correlation to it.
There's a lot of passion there.
Like this.
Oh my God!
Justin's like,
yeah, all over.
Oh my God!
Yeah,
no, it's but yeah, it's so different from person to person.
No complaints.
One of the worst things I could only imagine is if you're with somebody who has a low sex drive and you have a high sex drive, or vice versa.
Right.
Because you could have everything else be healthy, but how do you?
Well, that was one.
How do you bring those together?
That was one of the biggest challenges that we went through in my relationship was. You know, going through this whole hormone thing, like I also happen to be with probably, I would say Katrina is, yeah, she's probably, yeah, I don't think I've ever dated anybody that wants to have sex as much as she does. So to be with the girl that wants more sex than any woman I've ever been with at the same time that I'm going through the hormonal challenges like that. That really definitely
I think her and Jessica have that in common.
Yeah.
Cuz I have yet like I at any given moment my girl could be like, "Oh my God, my head hurts. I don't feel good." And I'd be like, "You want to do it?" She'd be like, "Yes." Like I've never now when I was married, it was not like that. The stars had to align, the planets had to be in the right
position. But was it like that before kids?
Yep. It was like that for most of the time, man.
Well, that's what I mean. It's like what you guys but are after describing kids, is after the same kids, it got thing worse. Courtney was like, before kids.
After kids, it gets a lot
then
worse.
Then the role reversed. Yeah. Because I couldn't like even keep up, man. Yeah.
In
the beginning.
And that's actually, a lot of guys think they want to be in that position. Yeah. But then you're like, fuck, man, I can't even, I need to like get good sleep.
It's just like underwritten thing. I mean, they want to have a kid, you know? Like it's like in the DNA. It's like.
What do you think it is about that really causes them to go from being... Because obviously the main drive is probably because they have this, you know, to reproduce right inside. And that's what probably drives that crazy sexual drive. Then they do. Do you think that's what it is? It's because they become elated. That's like, oh,
they accomplished it.
Right, right.
Yeah. There's a lot of things. Dude.
You're pretty much useless now.
There's a lot of things. First of all.
Pretty much.
I got what I wanted.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, man. No. Now go take a seat.
No. Think about it this way, okay? How would you... You've been through injuries and hormone changes.
Right.
Okay. You go through a pregnancy. First of all, your body's not yours for 9 months. That's what it feels like, at least. You change and grow and stretch, and all then stuff's coming out of your boobs, and your hormones are fucking way different. And you're not getting good sleep. I wouldn't want to have sex either.
Yeah.
Okay. I wouldn't either. And then afterwards, while you're breastfeeding, your hormones stay it's almost like menopause. While you're breastfeeding, and this is because your body is trying to prevent you from getting pregnant right away again. So there's that's going on. Then you have the kids, they grow up. Hormones takes a while for them to get back. Most the female clients that I would train would tell me that it would take them about a year or two to start to even feel normal again. But then on top of that, you have the added stress and all the added stress from having kids now. And then, of course, you may be more self-conscious of your body, because a lot of women's bodies... You know, even if you take care of yourself and stuff, there's certain things that happen that you may not have control over, like stretch marks.
Yeah, it's a lot.
Speaking of that, you know what I just happened to my buddy last week? This was hilarious. I didn't know this was possible. So they just had their kid, right? Right now, he's only a month old or so. And, you know, they're exhausted, like new parents. Just nobody's fucking sleeping or whatever like that. And they both pass out, like, on their bed. And I guess she skipped a feeding and she didn't pump, I guess, and I guess this could happen. And my boy wakes up because milk is squirting him in the face because her tits are fucking shooting out like fountains.
Wow.
I didn't know that could, I didn't know it was possible like that, dude.
Yeah, he gets backed
up.
Cool.
Yeah.
That's cool. That's cool.
Well, that's why he told me that, like, he was all freaked out about it. And I was like, I don't know. I probably
It's such a good thing that women have babies and not men.
Yeah.
For sure. Because we would just blast each other.
Yeah.
Like, for sure, if
turn
I ever
into
got,
a water gun.
Yeah, if I got pregnant, I'd come to work and you'd be like doing something, you wouldn't even, you'd be like, what
dude,
the fuck's hitting me
out
in the head? Like, fucking Sal, bitch. Yeah, for
come
sure
on, man.
For sure we blast each other all the time. No, it's a challenge. It's funny when they do like surveys and stuff on married people with children, they find it's such a catch-22. I had this conversation with Jessica the other day. People with kids report less happiness and more anxiety and more like, oh, it's like, it seems like it's all bad. But then they get to the question of,
yeah,
like
do you feel more fulfilled.
More fulfilled, yeah, and meaningfulness, right, and purpose. And it's yes.
And enriched and yeah, whatever term you want to throw
it's
out a, there. It's such different,
a,
but it's
it's such a dichotomy.
Deep.
I can clearly see, like, for sure without kids, I'd probably be having more fun, more excited, yay, more relaxation. All that. But then for sure I wouldn't have as much of the of the, you know,
now,
fulfillment.
Have you guys noticed a correlation between exercise and your guys' sex? For example, like for me,
for sure,
I notice a huge difference in just,
especially when both of us are exercising.
My sex drive, how good the sex is, and how good of shape that I'm currently in. So if I'm consistent on the diet, I've been training. Like, everything's on the rise. Sex is up as far as the amount of it, and then how good it is, all that's on the rise. And if I'm like kind of like whatever, I'm inconsistent with that, my sex reflects it completely.
Yeah. For sure.
That's the go-to. Yep. Yeah, if things are a little bit rocky, it's like, let's get back to the gym.
Yeah,
right. Let's work on ourselves.
Yeah, if I'm feeling strong and healthy, then I'm definitely more sexual, more horny.
And her too, it's the same. It's you just want them, like, you want to feel good and you want to be able to bring that into the relationship. And, you know, if you're working on yourself, you feel a lot better.
Well, I was always told this was like a chick trait. Like, I thought it was a girl thing that, you know, girls have to feel sexy in order to want to have sex.
Because they don't always talk about it.
Yeah, I feel that way. Like, if I feel down on myself or I feel, I'm not
you
a sexual.
You do with the lights off?
Yeah, dude. You know, Katrina makes fun
of
me all the time.
My man
that.
Boobs.
Really?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I'm not even like consciously doing it. Subconsciously, I'm doing this where when I'm not really feeling myself, you know, I wait till the last minute to strip down and get naked. I turn the lights off and then go to bed, and then I get naked and get into bed.
Oh, I'm a fucking lights on. I love it.
Oh,
well, turn everything on.
Now when I'm feeling good about myself, so I'm like absolutely. I'm the guy gets like out of the shower and then I don't even put any clothes back on. Really? I'm walking around.
See, I'm just so visual that I like to see things, but I can have fun with the lights off.
I don't like seeing shit when I don't look good. You know, when I look good, I like seeing.
Well, I'm not looking at me.
Yeah. No, I'm talking.
Oh yeah, I forgot you have sex with yourself.
I'm not talking about
I know what you mean. You feel self-conscious.
Right. Yeah, I'm talking about you guys and your sex drive, not the correlation between your girls being in shape and working out. I'm talking about just you yourself. Yeah. Like, there's a direct correlation for me. Like, when I'm in shape, when I'm feeling good, sex is up. Not anything to do with her.
Think it has to do with the visual or the fact that you just feel better from working out?
I think both.
Yeah.
For sure, both. Right. Because obviously, and we've talked about this with my hormone levels, as soon as I started lifting heavy again and stuff like that, there was an instant spike in testosterone. Mm-hmm. So that helped. And then as I've continued to progress over the last month or two, watching the physical change happen in my body and stuff like that has made me feel that way too. And then I feel myself walking around the room naked and stuff, where before I would leave my clothes on longer before I take them off and stuff. So
no, I like.
I'm always ready.
Yeah. So you don't like lights on either, huh?
I do lights on, but I don't know. It's just too, like, my eyes, like, squinty. Like, I like just a little bit of light. Yeah, dim lights.
Pitch black can be fun, too, though.
Yeah.
Because then it's mysterious.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
I wake you up and we kind of, you know, like, get frisky.
How do you get your girls in the mood? Well, I mean, you probably the other way around.
Yeah.
Let's say you want to have sex. You just go up to your girl and say, let's do it.
Yeah.
Done.
My girl's more like this. If I say that I want to have sex, you know, her response back to me is, you better not be talking shit.
Yeah. Don't get my hopes up.
Don't be fucking with me, man.
Yeah. Don't be talking shit. That's the response I get.
How does she get you in the mood then? Because you're the more complicated one.
Huh? Yeah, I am. I'm definitely more complicated.
So what does she do?
If you were to ask her, she'd probably tell you she's still trying to figure it out. She'd probably tell you, like, you know,
slips you stuff in your drink.
So dirty talk doesn't work?
No,
that's
No. Mm. You know, in fact, the more she tries, the less I want to. So I think still the male side of me still wants to hunt. And
you
want to
be the pursuer?
I do want to pursue still. So she can't just. And so my girl, when we first started dating, she was, you know, she thought that was like, you know, you just grab my dick and like, I'm going to be in the mood. Like, it doesn't work for me. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't turn me on. You know, I'm also not like, oh, don't touch me there. I'm not that guy either. But, you know, at the same time, I'm like, that's not going to, I feel like I need to chase her a little bit. So she
feed me chocolates or something.
She knows to play possum a little bit with me. You know, so okay. she'll and I know she does. You know, she'll come in my when I know she really wants to. She goes in early to the bedroom. She showers. You know what I'm saying?
And she's all ready.
Yeah, I smell the lotion, and she's got the cute little lingerie of matching panties and underwear. You know, it's like 8 o'clock, and
just
she's
hanging out.
Yeah. Right.
Like doing work on the computer.
Yeah. She's doing work like on her knees on the computer. like really?
What are you working on? Let me. Oh, that's porn.
What's going on over here?
Fuck? Yeah. And she does a little look back over her shoulder to see if I'm looking. Right. So like, yeah, I see you, dude. I see you. Don't trip.
No, for me, I just have to say something or just take my shirt off. Yeah. That's the funny thing. I take my shirt off. I'm like, I better get ready to have sex.
It's happening now.
For my girl to get me in the mood, I mean, she'll do it. If she just grabs me, usually that'll probably work. But if I'm kind of like stressed or whatever and that's not really working, she just has to start talking dirty. I know how she does it too. She'd be like, you know what I was thinking about the other day? And I'll be like, oh, really? What were you thinking about? And it'll be like, the filthiest thing ever. I'm like, oh, shit. I didn't expect that. We're having sex.
That's a really cool thing. Talking about your sex with the partner. So that's a great tip for people that are trying to get their partner in the mood. Whether you're a girl or a guy, I've found this really successful, right? That if you... I'm saying if you are a girl moves. Or a guy.
He's all, I found this successful with guys and girls.
Hey, dude.
Works on everybody.
Is talking about, you know, like a great question to prompt or ask is like their favorite times with you, right? The favorite, what were some of your favorite moments or favorite things that you've done?
What about fantasies? You ever ask your girl, try this, ask your girl, what is the most naughtiest fantasy you've ever had in your own mind?
Yeah.
No holds barred, no boundaries. I don't care what it is. Didn't you know it's in your fantasy, so it's safe. What is that?
And then they're like, yeah, I don't have any.
No, they have them. They're just afraid that they're going to get judged. Trust me. Everybody has them. Get them to
that's
release.
That's where she goes, well,
gone down that road.
You know your co-host, Adam?
Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
That won't work on me. That'll work on me. I'd be like, really? Tell me about all my friends.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
We'll have an argument later. Oh, first, we're having sex.
Yeah.
No, you ask and see, but I think people have to feel safe. They have to feel. Everybody has filthy, crazy fantasies, of course. Right, Justin?
Yeah. Really dark ones.
What's your dark? What's your move? What's your move? Moves.
What's my moves to kind of get it going?
Pour him a drink.
Yeah, drinks are good.
Right. I feel like I could picture you at your house and like Courtney comes over and she like pours some scotch for you. You're like, oh, it's oh, going
okay.
down.
Yeah, things are happening. Usually that's an indicator. Like she'll have me go to the store and get something because it's. I think it's more just to like lighten the atmosphere a bit and like relax. Yeah. And so I know it's going to be successful based off the conversation we have on the couch. And that's like once the kids are down and like we're relaxed and we're chill and we're watching like a good show or something like and it's usually, I mean, probably 90% of the time when I'm not thinking about it or trying and then I'm just really fucking in tune with what she's talking about. You know, I'm just like, I'm really paying attention to her.
See,
like not being an asshole, you know, for once.
So basically you just have to,
I just have to really listen to her. Yeah. You know, like intentively, you know, and I'm like, I'm learning this, you know, instead of just being like,
tell
me
about your day, babe.
Look at my dick and I'm like walking around. It doesn't really work. You know, like it worked in the beginning.
That's the problem.
That's the thing.
That's the problem.
I was tricked. Yeah. I was tricked. It totally changed now. Yeah. So I have to be a lot more suave and all this other shit.
Suave.
How about you guys see how defensive Katrina got when we brought up the massages and where my massage is down from when we first met?
Yeah. Well, you are spoiled, dude. I have to side with her. I'm on her side.
Yeah.
You were complaining that she used to massage you every day and now she massages you 3 days a week.
Yeah.
Oh.
Tough life.
Poor guy. Yeah. Full body massage by a professional massage therapist.
Yeah, I'm getting massaged by dudes over here. Fuck you.
It's not that, though. It's imagine this, right? So, because it's hard for everyone to understand that, right? Imagine if you married like a fucking, like a super chef, like on TV.
No, I know.
Like and every night you had fucking gourmet five course meal.
Yeah.
Every night.
You get conditioned.
Like, yes, right? Yeah. And you're like, we didn't talk about this yesterday when we were all together, but I remember like vividly, like having a conversation with her, like, you got to stop doing this.
Yeah.
Like you
you're spoiling me.
Yeah, you're ruining me. Yeah. I love to do this. I love to do this. You know, so I love it. It relaxes me. I love to. Right. So she's constantly closing me on how it's no big deal, and it's like second nature to her to do that. And I'm going like, this is changing my life. You know what I'm saying? Like this is a big deal, man. Like getting this every single night.
How are you supposed to say no to that?
Right. And yeah, and her, you know, in her defense, that was back when she ran the clinic and she didn't have to get to work till 10 o'clock in the morning. And you know, we were living the life at that time. And so
she closed you, man.
Oh man. And then now, and here's the thing too. It's like, again, back to the chef reference. I'm sure somebody who's been with a chef like that can tell when they really get down in the kitchen versus when they kind of throw something together, like warming up in the microwave. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what.
So you're getting the microwave massages?
Well, I should just don't. No, honey, I don't think they're microwave massages. Not at all. You know what I'm saying? They're still they're still way better than I'll get anywhere else. So it is tough.
It's like Outback. Yeah. It's like it's fast food, but it's okay. It's got steak.
It's good.
Maybe that's a better analogy. It's still good. Like I'm not complaining, right? But I can feel in her hands. I can just feel the difference when she is doing it. Like when she's okay, I'm gonna put it down.
She's busy.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. No. Yeah. I'm not fucking complaining right now. I'm just saying that because everyone gives me shit about that. I'm like, if you only knew. You know what that was like to have that for every single night like that. She did condition the fuck out of me, man. Mm. And then I'm like, maybe, and it ruined all other massages because then I went on a kick for a while. I remember when she used to get mad at me because I was so used to getting massages all the time. So I started going to paying for it. You know, I'm like, okay, well, I want them. It was changing my life. I mean, her massaging me for that
she
year.
She like a little bit jealous when you go get a bunch of other massages.
Oh, she does not like me to go get massages anywhere else. Talk shit. You know what I'm saying? I knew it would be horrible.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, and she's right. I mean, I guess it'd be like me coaching her and teaching her and training her and then her go hire some fucking newbie trainer that's going to supposedly coach her and help her.
Yeah, that would sting a little.
Yeah.
Right? If your girl's hired a trainer.
Yeah.
So I'm sure
it's like, I like Steve.
I'm sure it's like that.
Steve trains me better than you.
So you were saying about motivation earlier.
Oh, yeah. You know, and I try not to like, I don't want to sound like I'm a hater on it, but...
Oh, I like it. Let's get going.
Yeah, well, ooh. I just...
Let's start the hater train. Let's go. Yeah.
Well,
Hate parade.
I just feel like so... is it really motivation, right? Like, so you see a lot of these people on Instagram, especially Instagram right now, because I guess the feed's so fast, right? And because I follow a lot of fitness people. So my feed is just flooded full of these, like, inspirational quotes and inspirational monologues that these guys and girls do. And it's just a bunch of fluff to me. And I think a lot of people think they really like it and are drawn to it because the initial reaction you get, because even I do too. I mean, nothing gets me fired up more than hearing like Ray Lewis give like a 2-minute like motivation speech like that. It gives me goosebumps. Sometimes I would listen to stuff like that before I go to the gym. Yeah. But I feel like so many people tune into that stuff in order to give themselves motivation to do something. Mm-hmm. And it's always short-lived when you do that. You know what I'm saying?
Of course.
Yeah.
Because it's not...
How can you possibly... Motivation's a feeling. Like all feelings, they come and they go.
It literally is a spark, and that's about it.
That's it. And when you get it, here's how I like to use motivation. When I feel very motivated, I get in this state of hypomania where I consume as much information as I possibly can. I produce tons of content. I come up with new ideas, and it's fun and it's addicting and it's exciting, and I can see why people want to chase it. And I've had several times in my life where I've stayed in these states for months on end, and it's just you're unstoppable. But they come and they go like any other feeling, and you have to have the other side. Because well, here's the thing. A feeling doesn't mean anything if there is no contrast. In other words, happiness is nothing without sadness, you know, light without dark. Like the only reason why it's called something is because it's contrasted from something else. You have to feel other ways. And so sometimes you're going to be motivated, and sometimes you're going to be normal, and sometimes you're going to be unmotivated. Is the key to try to chase the state all the time? I mean, I guess you can figure out things that help get you motivated, and that's cool. There's nothing wrong with that, but you're still never going to be motivated all the time.
Yeah.
What do you do when you're not motivated? Because the problem with trying to be motivated all the time is you only do stuff when you're very motivated. And I know a lot of people like this.
Oh, it's very much the on and off the wagon mentality, right?
That's it.
I have to have this driving mechanism. I have to have this like energy that's all narrowed into this one direction. And if I don't have it, you know, then what? I guess I just have to wait until I get that feeling to come back. And people just, it becomes this perpetual trap. It's like I get up and then I get down. I get up and then I get down. And there's just not consistency there.
Yeah. It's kind of like a parent who has to constantly tell his kid to do something versus a kid creating a habit out of it, right? Mm-hmm. I feel like it's the same thing when it's like you don't want to have to be told every time you need to go to the gym. Like the reason why I think I feel so passionately about this is because many, many clients that I train that didn't see the long term results were the ones that hired me for the motivational piece.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know,
they're the ones that they love to get fucking hammered.
Yeah, they want
to
get
for like 3 months.
Yeah, they want me to yell at them. They want me to count loud. They want me to push
them.
They
just drain you of all of your energy and everything. Right. Like suck the life out of you.
Meanwhile, and it took me years into my career before I really realized that I was not helping these people.
Yeah.
Sure, I was helping them for that 1 hour to get through that workout, but I really wasn't installing good habits and teaching them good behaviors getting them to understand nutrition and programming. What I was doing was hyping them, you know, like, let's do this. Yeah. Let's work.
And I can do that very well. I got really good at that. I could do that for a lot of people, but it's not a long-term strategy at all. I like to use, when I would manage gyms or I would use that for specific events or for specific times. Like, look, normally we're consistent. We work hard. Today is different. Today is the whatever. It's the final day of this or it's that. We're competing with. Now we're going to use the motivation to push us over the edge. But consistency is what wins the race. Consistency is what develops. It's all about good patterns, good behaviors. It's about finding meaning and purpose behind what you're doing. Otherwise, you're going to be fucked. You'll be in this. And what really irritates me is our space in particular, there's categories of charlatans that exist in the fitness and health space. And one category are these people who make these posts about, you know, you got to get up and make it happen.
Yeah.
And it's all about hard or go home and don't waste your time and fucking blah, blah, blah. And it's like, shut up, dude.
You're failing and I'm winning.
Yeah, you have no idea and it's just not effective.
Well,
it doesn't
work. It's so generic, like the advice that they're putting out there. Like nothing is very specific as to like, am I getting something out of this? Am I getting a real tool that I can use and apply to my life versus just somebody sort of barking at me and waking me up and getting my attention. I get really irritated listening to a bunch of general statements being thrown out there that it's like, yeah, no shit.
Right.
You know, like, no shit. Like, like tell me something applicable.
Right.
Like, give me some kind of substance and then I'll pay attention to you.
What do you guys say to somebody that actually that would like disagree with this right now and be like, I love that stuff. And that when I love listening to motivational videos and quotes and
so do I,
it helps me out. Right. I do too.
Yeah.
So like, what do you say to that person who thinks that it is worth it? And why would you say it's not?
Cool? I don't think it's not worth it. I think, you know, I enjoy watching
the
frequency
of it.
I love reading motivational quotes. I love reading stories about people who overcame difficult odds to do tremendous things. I love all that stuff too. I think everybody does. It's existential, right? We all enjoy that. The problem that I get is when people are led to believe, or when people just falsely believe that that's the key.
Yeah, that's where it stops.
Yeah, like this is it. I got to be like this all the time.
Yeah.
Which,
well, I think of it like this. Like, I mean, exercise is exercise science. It's a science, right? It's math and science combined. And motivation would never get you through the most complex mathematical equation or figure out how to do something scientifically. So
you need to have the formula.
Right.
You have
so that to me, it's like it would be like seeing this complicated math problem and doing something to pump you up to try and answer it. Mm-hmm. Like as your practice to try and learn versus.
You're like, I keep believing I can do it.
Right, right. If I believe hard enough,
that's great.
Right. If I grind at it hard enough, but if you're not taking the actual steps to learn how to solve the problem or learn on how to create this as a habit or behavior. And so then you're just really just kind of running it. And that's what I feel about the motivation is I feel that it's because we're talking about something unique. Like I like motivational speeches for an athlete who's getting ready to go into battle, right? You're about to walk out on the field. You've practiced all week. You've put in all the X's and O's. You've done all the math. You've figured everything out. You're about to walk on this field. Your captain walks in and he fires you up to go into war. Yeah. And you go out there and you put everything that you've been practicing to work, right? Then you have this motivation stuff in the fitness right now, or these people are just hyping people up to get after a workout and nobody's approaching it the right way. And in fact, I think it promotes people to go after it the wrong way. Yeah. Because when you get hyped like that, you naturally gravitate to intensity.
Yeah.
You know, it becomes don't quit, go after it, push harder, go further, which again, there's places for this, right?
So burn relationships, go all in.
The way I use motivation now, and like I'll use it with a client where I'll talk to someone and I say, listen, like, so I've been training somebody for about 2 months right now. And, you know, and I've told her, like, she comes in and sees me one time a week. That's all I can do right now, right? I don't have that a lot of time to train clients or anything, but I'm helping her out. And I see her once a week and I say, let me be your pace car. And I said, so in other words, I do not want any of your workouts to be pushed beyond what I'm doing. So when I take you through a workout, the next week until I see you, that's your level of intensity. And then, so when she comes in for the next week, and you know, and not always, it depends on what I got going on calorie wise, what I'm teaching her. But every once in a while, I'll say to her, like, okay, today's workout, I'm going to stretch you a little bit. You know, so this, and I'm going to do it this way. Like, I'm going to push you a little bit more here, volume, and we're going to cut maybe rest periods a tiny bit right here. And so I'm preparing her that I'm going to stretch you just a little bit. And so be right. And so when it gets to that point of the workout where normally I let her stop or she wants to stop, I go, okay, I'm going to push you here. And like, and then there's the motivation for the minute. Or I'm going to hype her up or come on, three more or two more or whatever. And that's it. But it's very methodical about how I approach it. It's not just, Let's get this workout, you know, from the beginning to the end.
Well, motivation is a feeling, and it's also typically attached to a goal. So, like, I'm really motivated to lose this 20 pounds, or I'm really motivated to get stronger, or I'm really motivated to perform better. But part of the problem is, A, it's a feeling, and it can go away. And B, let's say it doesn't go away, and then you hit your goal, then you tend to have to make another goal. And this is where people they burn themselves out to the point where they don't want to do that particular thing anymore. Like, you can't keep getting stronger. That's impossible. You can't keep improving in your workouts. That's impossible. So that, when you tie motivation typically is tied to overcoming or achieving new goals. And so that becomes a big problem. Now, on the flip side of that, you know, if you're working out and you're trying to be fit and healthy and your goal is to remain that way, hopefully forever, you can have bouts of motivation where you have different goals. Like I do. I do that all the time. Like, sometimes I'll have a goal. Like, okay, I want to be able to deadlift 550, or I want to be able to do this now. I get that. But what keeps me going forever is I have found the enjoyment in the workout itself with no goal, with no need for motivation. I have the joy. The joy is in the act. Mm-hmm. And when you find joy or fulfillment in the process, then you don't need motivation. Because let's say I feel shitty today. Let's say I'm feeling like really, I just feel down. I don't feel good. I'm still going to go do this workout because I have found fulfillment and joy with that act of what I'm doing. And so it's something that I'm going to do whether I feel unmotivated
or whether I feel like motivated. You don't do it, but you're not going to punish yourself like you're just like falling off.
Right.
Like it's part of the process, the whole thing.
Right. So, you know, it's like, who's going to stay consistent longer? The person who...
It's normal to have off days.
Yeah, the person who enjoys running, the person who loves running for the sake of running, or the person who's running to get faster all the time. Mm-hmm. Honestly, the answer is quite easy.
Right.
The person who likes doing it every single day is the one that's going to do it every single day.
Now, do you think this is on the rise, though? I feel like it's, and I don't know if it's just because we're so easily connected now, and so maybe that's why in my 15 plus year career, I feel like it's more predominant now than in the space than I've ever seen it before. Now, do you think that's because of social media? Or do you guys really think that, like, is it on the rise? Like, this, I think do people need to be motivated like this?
No,
hyped up?
It feels good, dude. It feels good because motivation is like, it's dopamine, right? Dopamine is it's strongly associated with motivation, and it feels good. It's addicting. Look at the studies that they did with drugs like Ritalin and Adderall, right? Now, these are drugs that will raise your dopamine levels quite a bit. And they did these studies to see if do these drugs actually make people smarter, because people say that they take them, they get better grades, they study more, and they feel like it's a intelligence-enhancing substance. Now, when they did the studies and actually tested people on their intelligence, were they improving their cognitive function? Were they thinking smarter? The results came back, no, they were the same. The difference was when people took the drugs, they just felt like they wanted to do what they were doing more because of that motivation chemical popping into their mind, because it feels good. So although they're doing the same thing and they report like, oh, I am smarter, they're not. It's just they want to read now, or they want to, because of that dopamine. So it's addicting. So of course it's going to be popular. Like I said, I love watching that shit too. It's a great feeling to hear someone talk or speak, have something resonate, get that feeling inside of you like, whoo, fuck yeah, let's do this, you know?
Do you think it's for some people and not for other people?
Yeah, I definitely do. I honestly think that it's kind of like, I guess, politics in a way, where I feel like I'm...
This will be interesting. Analogy.
I don't understand how people think or are so swayed by like somebody's opinion. You know, like, why are you so affected by that? Why don't you think for yourself? And I feel like motivation is very similar in where they need to draw off of somebody, and they need somebody to do something significant for them to find significance in themselves.
How about the people that actually are giving the motivation? Like, how exhausting.
Oh yeah.
How exhausting.
Bro, I feel like half those people are not speaking.
They're on cocaine.
Well, I feel like...
Let's be honest.
Maybe. Yeah. I feel like half the
Billy
time...
Blanks.
Half
the time a 50-50 shot.
Right? Like, yeah. it's a fair guess.
I feel like a lot of them preach what they're preaching, and they're saying it to themselves, really. Like, they're on the stage being like, you got to do this, you got to do that. Yeah. They're talking to themselves.
I believe that.
I think a lot of them are talking to themselves.
I believe that. I think that's why it comes out really good. That's why it probably works really well, because that's all they are. They're speaking their heart, but it's really back at themselves. Like, I need to do all these things, and that's what makes me say all this shit.
There's a whole market. There's a big market for
huge.
That.
Huge. It's a huge
market.
It's annoying. It's so big, dude.
I know. It really annoys me. Like, I'm not a fan at
the
all
parts
of motivational
that,
people.
The parts that annoy me the most are the ways, and I don't, look, again, if there's a market for it, whatever, it's a reflection of consumers.
Sure.
Still annoys the shit out of me. That these guys, we were just watching a guy, I'm not going to say his name, but we were just watching a guy, and it's the same shit, like, coming out of my private jet, and check out my fucking cool Bugatti, and I had hard
times. I had nothing.
It's the same story.
I lost millions of dollars.
Yeah, I grew up in hard times. I was a single mom. My mom was addicted to whatever. I lost an arm or whatever. It's always some crazy story, and then I came back from the depths of hell, and here I am today to show you and tell you it's possible for you to own a fucking jet like me and have all these hot chicks and be super. It's the same like fucking story. In fact, there's a formula for it.
It literally has happened time and time again.
There's literally a formula for it. I know, because I actually have been to conventions.
So this is what I mean by
about the formula.
This is what I mean by how daunting, like, or stressful, or I don't even know the right word for how I would feel as a motivational type speaker, because you have to know, right? You have to know whether you're on Instagram or YouTube, or you're doing talks, you're big enough to be doing TED Talks and shit, where you're 80% plus of the people out there, you're zero impacting their lives, 100%. Like what you say, 80% of those people out there will not follow through and execute any of the fucking bullshit that you're saying. Like,
right.
So it's got to be, this was what bothered me as a trainer for a really long time, because I felt like all this showing people stuff and pushing them and motivating them through their workouts.
And how deflating is it when you see them not, progressing.
Like, I'm not really changing their life. Sure, I got them in shape for the time that they hired me and paid me. Like, that's...
And then that was it.
That's not life. That's not a life changer. Like, that means I'm good at what I do. Like, I'm good at math and science. Like, that's all that fucking means, right? Like, it doesn't mean that I've really motivated them or changed them. So I've motivated them for a short time to get them to do something, but I haven't fundamentally changed their life. Like, I don't want someone to DM me or message me and say, man, I listened to the podcast and you got me so motivated to work out. And, you know, I had such a great workout after. No, I don't want to hear that. I'd rather hear, say, like, wow, you said something and it totally just impacted my life, or I had to really
fundamental way.
Yeah. I just had a girl, someone, I one of the last quads we did, I don't remember the question that she talked about. It had something to do with, cardio, kickboxing, or teaching multiple classes, and I was calling out the people that do that, and you know that it's terrible if you're trying to build muscle. And I don't remember the rant that I went on, but she was like, you know, I was the one you called out, and she thanked me. And I'm like, to me, that's like, I know that that person, I hit something, I hit home for that person that she was doing that was probably not helping her. Mm-hmm. And I just gave her something that hopefully will forever fundamentally change her. She'll never approach her training.
Well, I don't mind motivational speakers if they're providing real, like, tangible value.
Yeah, but how do you measure that?
You know, well, there's certain ones,
there's fluff, and then there's real gyms.
Yeah,
in it.
like someone leaves and like, okay, here's some things I can do to improve
like an action plan.
My life. Here's some things that I can do to change, you know, what's happening. Like, Jordan Peterson, I enjoy quite a bit. He's not a motivational speaker, but guess what he does? He ends up motivating a lot of people. Some of the stuff he says.
That's different. I think we get that a lot of time for people that say that, because we're definitely not motivation speakers for sure. But people are motivated to work out and exercise and be better. Because I think we're growth-minded, and we share our process of trying to grow and be better, and therefore that then...
Well, we're all motivated by other people as well. Like, it's a different thing when you see somebody doing something significant where you're like, oh, wow, they're doing that. That's awesome. That's impactful. Yeah. Like that charges me up.
Well, here's a significant thing that I heard him say that I thought was brilliant that I've said for a long time to clients. And one thing he said is, look, you know, you improve yourself today, and if you're having trouble with that, it's because you're not aiming low enough. And I thought about that. I'm like, well, that's exactly what happens to a lot of people. People come to us, and I've talked to clients like this. I'd say the second half of my career, this was what made me far more successful as a trainer than my first half of my career. People would come to me with these goals, need to lose all this weight, need to get healthy, totally deconditioned, totally unhealthy. And I would say things like, okay, here's your meal plan, here's your exercise, here's your whatever, and they'd be excited because I've given them the solution. And inevitably, it wouldn't work because it was too much. Right. Later on, what I realized was they came to me and I would aim way lower. Here's what I want you to do today. I want you to drink 5 glasses of water. Let's start with that. And they'd look at me like, well, no, that's not. And then I would ask them, well, how many glasses of water are you drinking now? And they'll say, like one, maybe a half, the rest is soda. And I'd say, okay, it's an improvement. You're better. So that's where we're going
to
start.
Oh, I'd ask somebody what their goal is, and this would always happen, right? They'd give me a picture of someone or show me what this girl looks like. I want to look like this. Mm-hmm. That's my goal. And I'm like, that's not your goal. I said, what your goal should be before you even set a goal like that is, how about just for a week, like, tell yourself you're going to track your food.
Yeah.
Like, have you ever just wrote down what you ate for an entire week? That's a better goal. Set that goal, accomplish that goal.
And that's
what I'm saying. And then set another one that stretches that a little bit further.
And that's the meaning behind you're not aiming low enough.
Right.
It's because a lot of times people say, well, I'm not going to do that because that's not enough.
That's because that's stupid.
Yeah. That's not going to make that big of a difference.
Aim for the stars, shoot for the moon, land on the stars.
Yeah, bullshit. No, it's literally aim low enough to where you're making a small change and then stick with that, and then aim low again and make another small
There's
change.
There's a lot of brilliance in that statement.
Very brilliant.
There is.
But that's a gem. That's
but
different.
But it took me a long time to piece that together as a trainer, because you know, your client comes in, they pay for you, they hire you, they tell you their goal. Who am I to say, no, that's not a good goal? You know what I'm saying? My job is to, like you said, give you the formula for that goal.
That's right.
I have the formula for that goal. Problem is, you know, 80, 90% of them will never execute
it. It ain't going to work, because it only works when you're highly motivated. Because if a client comes to me, let's say they just came from a Tony Robbins seminar or someone really, you know, motivational, and they came to me like, that's it, I'm getting in shape, Sal, I'm fucking pumped,
everything is changing.
And I tell them, drink 5 glasses of water a day. They're like, I'm going to the trainer over there that's going to tell me all the stuff I can do because I'm fucking pumped right now.
At once.
Right. Yeah. That's what I mean. Like, those small changes, those really small incremental changes in reality are the ones that are going to give
you... Well, that's the proving grounds.
That's it. That's going to give you the lifelong
change. If you can't master that one small thing and you want to just skip ahead...
Right.
Well, this is also how you create self-motivation, too. Because every time you accomplish one of those goals, it becomes more motivating. You get one win, then you get two wins, you get three wins. Next thing you know, you become very confident. You're confident because you're winning all the time. You set goals and you're accomplishing them all day long. So what if they're small goals?
That's it.
Yeah. If they're improvements and you're a better version of yourself today than you were yesterday, you're on the right fucking track.
And sometimes,
really simple as that.
Sometimes all you need to do, because sometimes people are like, well, I don't know where to start. Like, what do I do? And of course, from the outside, I could tell you a million things you could do.
Yeah.
Everything from, you know, get your car washed, organize your drawer, or small things that are just better than you were yesterday. But people sometimes have trouble. So you can reverse it and say, okay, I bet you can name 10 things that you do right now that make your life more difficult. Like, there's 10 things you do right now that are making it hard for you to be fit and healthy.
Right.
So why don't you just stop doing one of them?
How do we figure that out?
Yeah, just stop doing one of them. Take one of them off. And so they're like, okay, every night before dinner, I have some ice cream. So I think I could just stop that. You know? And you just, and that's it. But that's not motivation. That's value. That's real value. Because motivation is not, I guarantee
it's action.
Well, back to my math and science analogy. I mean, it's you're learning the formula. Like, you're literally learning how to solve the equation versus just like throwing shit at it. Like, let's just get after it and we'll figure it out along the way. It's like, let's methodically break this big equation, because it's a big equation. To get yourself into this like crazy shape that whatever goal you have, it's a major equation. So let's break it up into smaller ones that are easier for you to understand, and then we can build on that and it'll compound.
And that's why most fitness programs that are sold, or products that are sold on the internet, are these 30-day blast your body, get you in shape quickly. Because what they sell you on is that motivation. Mm-hmm. You go to this site, there's this video that's fucking hyping you up, and you're already in the state of mind where that's it, I'm going to get in shape. Yeah. Now you're like, oh, this workout, super
they
fucking
throttle
hard.
Throttle as hard as they can while they have you in that state of mind.
That's right. 30 days? Fuck yeah, I'm going to do this workout twice a day every day or beat the crap out of myself. I'm going to do that. I'm hyper-motivated. They buy that. Yeah. Meanwhile, you have Mind Pump, who's like, hey, we have a super bundle. It's a year of exercise. Right. You're going to probably need a year, and it's going to move you through real slowly and get you.
You're going to learn a lot.
Or you challenge like Joe D does with all his programming, right, where he gives people fucking 500 sets of everything for a workout, and he's looks superhuman himself. Right. And so then everybody's trying, like, oh, man, if I could just get to a point where I could finish one of those workouts, I'm going to look like him one day.
Yeah, imagine if only. Imagine if you needed motivation to, like, brush your teeth or take a shower. You know how many people wouldn't do it? Seriously, it's just a part of their routine. It's their behavior. And so really it's just making it a part of what you do. Learn how to enjoy it. I used to tell clients this all the time. They would come to me and be like, Sal, what's the best, most effective form of cardio? I need to burn calories. Like, which one's going to burn the most calories? I say, do the one you like the most. That's the best one.
Right.
The one that you like the most is going to be the most effective one. Because I could tell you, I could find the numbers out and be like, oh, okay, the rower is going to burn the most calories, but you hate the fucking rower. Guess which one's going to not work for you? That one.
Right.
So just pick the one that you enjoy the most. Right, that's it.
I'm still waiting to see a motivational guy be like, you got to rest and recover. Meditate.
Rest hard.
Meditate.
Fucking rest as hard as you possibly can.
You fucking pussy.
Yeah. No, and you know, and again, it's addicting. It's fun. And there's nothing wrong with it. I'm not
opposed
to it.
Well, the other thing is, too, is that it's the feel that people get, right? Because they feel like when they train hard like that, like, and you get this immediate feedback. And that immediate feedback doesn't necessarily mean that it's not or good feedback, right? It's like, just because you can barely walk out of the gym, that is not an indicator of a great workout. Mm-hmm. Like, that is not an indicator that you're necessarily doing the right things.
Even if you're an athlete, I would tell athletes when I would train them, the only time you should feel like you can't move is after your performance.
Right.
Like, when
you gave everything you got.
When you're competing.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
But in the gym, you should leave and you should feel good. You should leave and be like, wow, I feel really good. My body feels calm.
Well, that's when you're testing yourself.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Like, you save those moments when you're fresh, and then you're going to test yourself. But the rest of the time, you're training.
That's it.
And training is a totally different thing. That's a lifestyle.
That's it. But, you know, I get up every morning and then I work out, and I'd say 80% of the time, I'm not motivated. I don't have a goal. I'm not going out there to fucking go crazy, because it doesn't work that way. 80% of the time, I'm going out to work out at 5:30 in the morning because I love the process of it. I just go out. It's like, this is one of my favorite.
Do you think a part of the reason why a lot of people too are drawn to the motivation hype stuff is because they don't have the self-belief? Do you think because they deep down, they actually truly don't believe that they can do it? Mm. And so the hype and the motivation gives them that artificial feeling like they can for a minute.
You know, I think that, and I think part of it is when you perceive something as work, we tend to not want to do it. And that, I think, has happened a lot with working out, like exercise. I mean, shit, work isn't the word working out. So like, if people are like, oh, I have to go do this really hard work, it tends to diminish it. There's a term for it where athletes who play because they love playing start to lose their love for what they're doing when they start to get paid to do it, or when it becomes their job. Mm-hmm. Yeah. All of a sudden they start to lose the the same excitement and enthusiasm.
Oh, it's very common.
Yeah.
That's why there's a lot of people that are probably listening that are more fans of watching college sports than professional sports for that exact reason. Yeah, there tends to be more passion in collegiate level athletes because they're trying to make it, right? Because making it to the...
It's still somewhat pure, like the intention behind, a lot of the play and what you see on the field being expressed versus like somebody trying to keep their job and survive.
Right. Mm-hmm. This is why I'm actually... So there's a lot of controversy right now with the NBA and what's happening with all... Like right now, the trade deadlines are going on and all these players are switching teams. And like we've never seen this in the NBA before, like where... All these players, like typically like in an NBA season, so let's go back 15 years in the NBA during the off season, you see like maybe, five or six moves. Player gets traded or free agency or whatever. And maybe out of those five or six moves, one or two of them at most are like a big deal. Like a big player goes to another big team or something. You're like, oh shit, so-and-so's in this team now. This is crazy. Where now, the last couple years, and definitely especially this year has been the most, there's players that are all moving all big time players with big names moving all over to all different teams and getting on the same team. And the only way that's possible because these guys all the teams have a budget they can work with. You can't just buy any player you want. Yeah, it doesn't work that way.
Cap.
Yeah, you have a cap. So, but for the first time ever, which is what I'm pro all this. There's a lot of people that hate on it because they're saying that these teams are stacking and it makes it shitty for the rest of the NBA. But I think it's great because what you're seeing is you're actually seeing players take less money so they can play together. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a really good thing for the game is to see that because for a very long time, I felt for about 10, 15.
You think some of them are chasing a championship?
Yeah. They want to win. Yeah, they want to win again. And that's becoming more important than an extra 10 or
like
15.
Like LeBron, right?
Right. An extra 10 or $15 million. Like some of these guys can go out because they're superstars, go get what they call a max contract where they take like one guy, like a superstar, like a Durant, for example, right? He could go to another team and get a max contract where they lock him up for 6, 8, 10 years and they pay him a fucking buttload of money. Which what happens is what does that do? Doesn't allow very much money for the rest of the team or for that team to go out and get other players.
You can't really build a team around him.
Right. And then who are we to say that's not fair? Because Durant, that's his own life. Like he should be able to go get as much money as he wants.
Right.
But for the first time, we're actually seeing players that are opting out of that, then they're not taking that so they can all play together. Now that he's not going broke, he's still making really good money. But that, I mean, that's it's easy for us to say because we're not making $50 million or whatever like that. That what's the big deal if you don't take 50, you take 40. But if you're somebody who's used to making $50 million and now you got to take $40 million, well, that's $10 million less that you're used to having. Like, who are we to say that that's not a big move? So I think it's really cool. A lot of people think that it's ruining the NBA. That's not true because all stats are showing the NBA as far as the headlines and the conversations that's happening and the people that are viewers that are watching it, it's increasing. But I think it's really cool to see these guys doing it. It's creating more of this team atmosphere where I felt like it was a lot of ISO ball just 10 years ago where it's about the money, it's about me. And that kind of killed the sport for me.
How much I could sandbag my stats and all that kind of stuff so that way I get in the Hall of Fame because this and that. So they're just shoveling the person, that one guy, the ball the whole time just so he could just put points
on. Well, that's cool. It shows that people are more interested.
Yeah, it's about the game and winning.
Maybe building a legacy.
Building up people around you. And
what's cool is that, and the Warriors is why it's so fun to talk about them right now, is that they are an example of how incredible a team can be when almost all the players are unselfish like that. Mm-hmm. And that's what makes them really scary and dangerous is it's not just one or two guys making a big move like that and say, hey, I'll take less money. It's like the whole team collectively saying I'll take that role. Mm-hmm. I'll come off the bench, even though I could go start for another team and I could be the man somewhere else. Like I'll come off the bench because I want to play with these guys. Like that's fucking cool, dude.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah,
you know? And everybody that wants to hate because you're not a Warrior, it's stupid.
Stop it.
That doesn't get you excited at all, just a little bit?
Actually, it is enthralling to hear. Yeah. I don't know anything about it, but when you're talking about it, it sounds good.
Okay, good. So my motivation is working.
But I know LeBron moved and I think
LA.
Yeah, he's trying to create a legacy, right? He wants to win the championship.
Yeah, he won.
Has he won?
Oh, yeah, he's already won.
He's always getting ragged on by not having as many as Jordan, right?
Right. So
maybe this is him trying to build his legacy.
Lock the legacy. I mean, in my opinion, it's already there for him, but
it's just it's a number.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I think the way he probably feels and a lot of people feel is that if and when he probably will pass the championships, that's the last like thing that
the last thing anybody can throw
at. Right, because there's, I mean, you
could, who has the most championships? Is it Jordan?
Jordan, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, no, most championships total, like as a player?
Yeah.
No.
Jordan. Chamberlain?
I think Chamberlain might. Google that, Doug. Robert Horry has 7, which is somebody who you would
Robert never. Robert Horry has 7?
Yeah, because he was part of the Lakers. Oh. He bounced from team to team that was winning championships during that little era that he was running around. So there's some players that have. I think Bill Russell has a ton. Mm-hmm.
What I find motivating is the understanding that regardless of how I feel, whether I feel pumped, hyped, and motivated, or I feel down, tired, and you know, depressed, I'm still going to move forward. Still going to get up, and I'm going to do what I need to do. I experienced this several times in my life. I experienced it. We started Mind Pump while I was going through a divorce. As I was going through that divorce, I had to do that. I had to get up and I had to move forward when I was very unmotivated, probably some of the most unmotivated times of my life. And I think that might be more of a key than seeking out motivation.
Oh, 100%.
You know?
Oh, 100%. I think that's it. Well, again, that's...
It's like, I'm going to move no matter what.
Well, because you create self-belief. That's why I say motivation is bullshit. Self-belief is everything.
That's it.
And I think... You being down, not wanting to work out, under that, getting there, accomplishing that, working through that, you know, that's what gives you that self-belief. I can do this. Even when I don't feel good, even when I'm down, even when the odds are against me, I don't need anybody else to tell me to do this.
Pick your ass up,
right.
Drag your ass over there, and just go. And if you can do it when you feel like that, then of course you're going to do it when you feel motivated. That's the easy part, you know? So check this out. We have free guides. I believe there's 12 of them. Some of them teach you how to train particular body parts. Others teach you how to do high-intensity interval training properly. They're all free, and you can find them all at mindpumpfree.com.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now, plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.